Can you please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance?
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America,
to the republic
for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening and welcome to the Hampton School Board, School Board, oops. Try that again. Good morning, good evening, welcome to the Hampton Board of Selectmen's meeting on January 23rd, 2017. Public comment, is there anybody in the public who'd like to speak? Come on, speak at the microphone, please.
Good evening to the Board of Selectmen. There isn't all here, 16 Presidential Circle. I read the agenda and I saw item 3 under the town manager's report. The town has been served with an administrative order from the Department of Environmental Services requiring the town to replace the Church Street sewer force mains via an overland route by December 17th. I'm going to relate to you my feelings here. It's not adversarial, just how I feel. Article 10, of course, is in this year's warrant article asking for $4,242,000 for this as well. I have no facts have been reported. No facts have been reported to the public that would substantiate this request. And I'm a fact-driven guy. This capital request of $4,242,000 would not make first cut in industry without facts and without analysis. I spent 50 years in industry with defect analysis and corrective action, managing and directing large departments. When it came to capital equipment requests, it was quite an inquisition, let me tell you. What I've heard to date is this. I have a feeling that these pipes need to be replaced. The beach would be shut down if a failure occurred during the summer. I wouldn't want to be here when that happens. They need to be replaced. The state would like that as well. That's all I've heard. Since then, I've done a lot of reading and a lot of research, blah, blah, blah. This is the first failure that occurred since they were installed. The first pipe installed 47 years ago, and the second pipe was 30 years ago. The risk when they were installed must have been known by DEA or DES, as well as the town, yet the pipes went in. Probably the pipes went in because it's the most cost-effective route, right from the church station, right to the wastewater treatment plant. Probably why they went in. But the risks at that time were the risks at that time. The defect that I see is an isolated and random defect with no evidence that a trend is in sight and that it's going to happen again. I looked at the pipe extensively that was removed. I saw no excessive wear. I did see the hole in the pipe created by the rock. By the way, the rock was really tough. It was granite-like in weight. I couldn't tell because it was covered with scrud, if you will, mud and whatever else is deposited on it. But it had the heft of granite or bedrock material that I think just kind of eroded up through the marsh and hit an object. It happened to be the pipe. The pipe is vacillating when it's processing the water, too. Well, the pipe showed no excessive wear as far as I'm concerned. I've got photographs, cross-sectional photographs. And just think, this pipe was corrected, by the way. The defect was corrected, I think, in 2 to 4 weeks at a pretty costly sum of money. Just think if we had a contingency plan, if we put together a contingency, how fast we could do it and how much it would cost. So no facts that I know of have been made to assess the risk. And there's plenty of areas to probe to assess the risk. I made a recommendation that we do ground penetrating radar or sonar to see if we are lying in a rock field. I planted a bush or a tree last summer and took 25 rocks out of there before I could get a 2.5-foot diameter hole put in. So are we sitting in a rock field? If we are, boy, it would start to incline me to change a little bit. Didn't happen. I sent emails twice. Pipes have never been listed on any big priority list as something we got to replace, just something that happened. And now we're in emergency action here. The state is no better off than we are from a fact point of view. So I don't know how they can issue this kind of an order. I sat with them, with Fred, in 2010 and 2011. They're human beings. They'll talk to you. They'll work with you.
Can we wrap it up? We're at our 3 minutes, please.
I don't intend to vote for this article unless I hear better risk analysis and better assessment. It's just too bad that this order comes from the state like a lightning bulb. It almost obligates people to have to vote for it without good risk assessment and analysis. I could have done much better, guys, if I had the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else would like to get up and speak? Seeing none, come back to the announcements and community calendar. Regina.
Nothing, Mr. Chairman.
Jim.
Nothing.
Phil.
Yeah, I do have a case of bursitis, so I will be standing from time to time. No disrespect intended to you, Mr. Chairman, or to the public, but it's rather bothersome, so I'll be standing from time to time. Thank you.
Yeah, and I just want to say that I was lucky enough to go to the inauguration, and it was really a very nice affair. It was, you know, I guess it takes a billionaire to make sure it's 50 degrees because the weather was beautiful. There were no lines. There were no crowds. It just was so much easier. I would say it was probably 40 to 50% less people than when I went the last time. But it was much better. It just was a much better affair, and it was... It was almost intimate, even though it was big. And it made me think that we've got a new guy, and I want to congratulate John for being at the Seafood Festival. And maybe the Seafood Festival would be, if they could think of a way to make as much money with less people, how much wonderful it could be. And I'm going to try to bring that subject up at the Hampton Area Commission when we have our next meeting. I don't know how you do that, though, and I'm sure the money is the most important thing, but this was a case where they had spent so much money at the inauguration on fences and this and that, and it was just really well done. It was a beautiful thing. So I was happy to be there, and again, congratulations to John.
Okay. Town Clerk Jane Cipher announces that the candidate filing period for the March town elections will be held Tuesday, March 14th, begins this Wednesday, January 25th, and closes at 5 p.m. on Friday, February 3rd. There are two selectmen, one treasurer, two trustees of the trust fund, two library trustees, two planning board members, a cemetery trustee, two budget committee members for a three-year term, one budget committee member, one-year term, and two zoning board three-year terms. Again, the office is open Monday through Friday, 8 to 5, Monday through Thursday, 8 to 5, and Fridays, 8 to 11:30, except on the February 3rd, where it'll be open till 5 o'clock. So, other than that, reminder that the deliberative session for the town of Hampton will take place on Saturday, February 4th at 8:30 at the Winnicott High School Auditorium. Okay, so the next thing we have is the consent agenda. We have a consent agenda for a limousine license to Robert Gendry, Seacoast Executive Transportation. And number two, we have veterans credit and veterans credits and blind exemption applications, and there is a number of them. So 28 of them?
28.
Okay, so without reading them, if you want to see who they are, you can pick up the agenda. So I have a motion for the consent agenda.
A motion to move the consent agenda.
Motion seconded. Okay, by all those? Unanimous. Approval of the minutes for January 5th, January 9th, January 10th, and January 12th.
I'll make a motion that we approve those minutes.
Second.
I think I was absent from one of those, so can we do those separately? I think.
All right, well, we can do them.
I was here.
We can do them separately. Let me pull them out so that we can. January 5th. And we have their copy. You get your copy. copy right there.
Do you have a copy?
Yeah, I think you...
The 9th. What's it?
The 10th?
The 10th.
Didn't say. Oh, the 9th?
I do have one correction on the 12th anyway, so...
And the 8th, you were here. Huh. Oh, the 5th you were here, sorry.
I guess I was here. I know I was absent once. That's all right.
So, the only one I had as a correction was on the 12th at the bottom. Selectman Waddell motion to adjourn, seconded by Selectman Bridle. It was a 3-0, and it was Bean that was not here, and Rick was.
Okay.
So that's the only correction I have.
Okay. Who wasn't here? I wasn't here.
At that part of the meeting, you weren't here. You were here earlier, but you had gone out, and you weren't here. So it's 3-0 with Bean and Rick.
Okay.
So, okay, a motion, a second. All those in favor? Unanimous. Well,
whatever you say, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. 3-2 abstained. What about that? Wow. Okay.
That's quite a pile.
Next one we have is Diana Martin.
Okay, so I have a lot of things to just throw out there for the community. In our parks maintenance department, our staff is scheduled to start working, you know, in the parks maintenance and field preparation in late March, early July, April. But both of them have been on different times to do general cleanup for the building, shoveling out the Tuck building, etc., because we use that year round. We just took the Christmas tree and the snowflake lights down for the gazebo in the street. I've been working with a company that won the bid for the playground at Five Corners on the details of the project, which they will be starting in May. Parking lots, we're kind of in the process of seeing who will be coming back this summer to work and finding out how many we need to hire for the season. And we'll be doing our training for that in the middle of May. Our recreation programs, we finished our holiday tree with the trees. Holiday season with the Tour of Lights, the Magic of Christmas Symphony Orchestra in Portland, the U.S. Army Jazz Ambassadors, the tree lighting ceremony, and the Christmas parade. We're setting up a number of programs and camps for the spring and summer that will be on the website soon and in our spring and summer brochure. These will include Tuckfield Summer Day Camp, surf lessons, archery lessons, Challenger Soccer Camp, Creative Kids Art Camp, Field Hockey Camp, Grant State Track and Field, Lego Robotics, Theater Camp, Red Cross Babysitting, Warrior Hoop Camp, Tennis Lessons, Tennis Camp, Camp A Lot of Fun, Mini Kickers, Cheer Camp, and a Tuckfield Family Camp Out and Flag Football Camp. We're in the process also of scheduling the fields for the upcoming softball baseball seasons, as well as scheduling for the lacrosse and tennis that's coming up. We're in the process of seeing who is returning to our staff for summer camp. We'll be sending out advertisements for staff, all of our summer staff, in the next month. The K2 sports program is in its third of five sessions right now, just started this week. We're in the process of setting up our training for all of our camp staff. We'll be having our annual Easter egg dig down at the beach on April 8th at 11 for children 12 and under. We're always looking for volunteers to help the Easter Bunny bury eggs that morning. So if anyone is interested in doing that, they should call our office. And it is really a lot of fun, especially if it's a beautiful sunny morning. And I think the Easter Bunny breakfast is that same morning, and we try and do them in conjunction with each other at the Village Preschool. The fishing derby this year will be in May for grades K through 8. The derby is free, but children just need to come to the rec office to get their fishing license for the day. The date will be announced soon for that. We've continued Zumba throughout the year, as well as other fitness offerings, including Bone Builders, Hampton Walkers, Yoga with Sue, Pilates, and Let's Get Moving Yoga for Kids. The local league, which is our high school rec basketball league, has started, and it runs through March 12th of this year. We have a trip going to the Boston Flower Show on March 22nd, and right now that trip is full, so we're hoping to either do another trip on March 23rd or expand this trip with a bigger bus. Our men's basketball league is in full swing right now on Tuesdays and Thursdays at the Marston School. We're waiting to hear what shows are going to be at the North Shore Music Hall and Ogunquit Playhouse, so shows and dates will be announced soon on that. We have set up trips to see the Red Sox at Yankee Stadium and at Fenway Park this year. The trips to Fenway are on Thursday, May 4th against the Baltimore Orioles, and the cost for that is $44. And on Wednesday, September 6th against the Toronto Blue Jays, also for $44. And our trip to Yankee Stadium is on Saturday, August 12th. The game time is to be determined. The ticket prices are $154 for infield seats and $134 for the outfield seats. The tickets include the game tickets, transportation, pregame tailgating party, foods, and beverages for the trip to Yankee Stadium. We've set up a number of trips to the Oxford Casino. In fact, we just had one last Thursday. The upcoming trips are Thursday, February 16th, March 16th, April 20th, May 18th, and June 15th. And the cost for each of these trips is $25 for residents and $30 for non-residents. We've set up a mystery trip for the seniors on April 26th, and the cost for this trip is $35 for residents and $40 for non-residents. We have a new class. We've set up a painting event for seniors. This program is scheduled for March 15th at 12 at the Tuck Building. $20 includes all materials, instructions, lunch, and refreshments, and participants will be painting a 12 by 16 canvas, and it's called Birch in the Snow. It's a birch tree. It's quite beautiful, actually. We've set up another session of mini kickers with a new name. It's called Tiny Tykes now. The age group for this soccer program are Cubs, which is 2 to 3 years old, and Lions, which are 4 to 5. This session starts on May 6th and runs through June 17th, and the cost is $85 for the session. We started a new program last fall that was so popular that we're continuing it again this spring. This program is called Spanish Immersion. This is an after-school program for students in grades 3 through 5 on Thursdays from 3 to 4. And the class runs for 6 weeks and is $60 for the session and actually started last week, but you could still get in on that. We've set up 2 sessions of Mindful Mondays. This unique and educational class includes instruction, mindfulness exercises, and fun sensory activities designed to encourage emotional regulation, positive self-awareness, and gratitude giving for boys and girls in grades 3 through 5. And the cost for this class is $45 per session, and the first session starts today and ends on February 13th. The next session will start March 6th and runs through March 27th, and each of these classes is held at the Tuck Building at 3 o'clock to 4:30. So the participants are picked up with our bus after school and brought to the Tuck Building for class, and parents pick up after class. That's becoming a very popular program also. We have also scheduled a trip to the Wright Museum for May 17th, but we'll have more details on that as far as the cost and the time. And we've scheduled another New York City dray trip for Saturday, May 20th, and the cost for this is $65. And we've set up another Freeport shopping trip on Wednesday, May 24th, if the cost for that is $25. And as we speak, Renee Boudreau is over at the school, and we've started our volleyball program back up again. So it starts tonight, if anyone's interested in that. And that is all, unless you wanted any of these flyers.
Any questions for Diana?
No. Thank you, Ms. Martin. You obviously are keeping very busy.
Yeah.
And thanks for what you do for the town and everyone.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah, Diana, thank you. I mean, that's a long list. And I would put that up against any recreation department in the town our size around here. And,
yeah,
sure. And you guys do a great job with the ball fields and everything. And lots of times I go to different towns because my grandkids play sports. And a lot of towns have a lot more to work with than we do.
Yeah.
And we do a great job with what we have.
Well, our guys, they take pride in their work.
They do.
Yeah.
So thank you very much for what you do.
Thank you.
Rick?
Sounds to me like you're having nothing but fun over there.
That's it. We're just playing all the time, Rick.
Well, you do a great job. And,
thank you.
Thank you. It really does sound fresh and inviting.
Bill?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director, kudos. Echo what everyone has said.
Thank
Keep
you.
Up the good work. Thank you.
Thanks.
Have we, on the, you're looking for your summer help already.
Mm-hmm.
Have we done a little PowerPoint program or something to put on Channel 22 or to put on your website to try to...
Nope, but we can totally do that.
Yeah, I think it would just, if we start getting out there early,
That's a great idea.
We might even talk with the, I say Channel 13, but I mean, because, you know, for the summer programs, we might be able to advertise some of our programs on Channel 13, which is the school channel, mm-hmm. which a lot of your programs have to deal with the school program. So mm-hmm. it might be an idea to see if we can cross-pollinate there a little bit and see if we can...
Yeah, I'll talk with Kathleen Murphy about that.
I think that would be a good... and.
Yeah, because we're hiring for summer camp staff, parks maintenance, and parking lot employees this summer.
So, you know, if we can get it out there. And on your website, too, or your Facebook page, you know, do something up on there for...
Yeah, we always do that, yeah.
That would be a great thing.
Yeah.
And if you notice a lot of this stuff, you know, you talked about the fishing derby, and you talked about the Easter egg hunt and stuff like that. But most of what you talked about right now is for the seniors and the adults, which is really good to hear. It's good that we have a lot of programs for them too, and the more we can get out there and let the seniors know that these are work out there, the better off we are. You're doing an excellent job, and we thank you for everything you're doing.
Yeah, we have a senior club that we're hoping to grow a little bit this year too. That meets once a month, and it's just a social club, and
excellent.
We're working on that pretty hardy right now.
Very good.
All right.
Thank you, Diane.
Thank you.
The next one up is Christy Pullman, the monthly financials. Good evening, Christy.
Good evening. All right. So tonight I'm here to kind of just give us a first pass at the 2016. Since I did these reports, I had another like $10,000 of invoices come in just today from like utilities, electric, and stuff. So I issued to you guys either Friday or Saturday, I can't remember now, just the memo. I didn't include the financials on purpose because they aren't final yet. So it just kind of gave you a memo of where we are at. So far, like I said, I just got another $10,000. We've been cleaning up the purchase order list for any purchase orders that no longer need to be active and things like that. So I'll just briefly read through where we are currently at, and then hopefully within the next week or two I will come back and have our final unaudited figures for 2016. All right, so it's the last report of 2016. The revenues are currently at $7,975,593, which is over the adjusted budget of $6,790,934 by $1,184,659. It should be noted here that the revenues used at the time of setting the tax rate were $7,612,533. So therefore, the revenues are really actually only over by $363,060 when you're looking at what would be considered excess revenues for the year. The board will need to vote if they wish to have the balance in the employee separation cost of $158,911.70 and the bank buyback program of $12,331.08 for a total of $171,242.78 to be transferred to the compensated leave trust fund, which is held by the trustees of the trust fund. If you so wish to do that tonight, you may. The expenses are currently running under budget by $578,106. In November, we were under budget by $736,279. So the gap has closed there. The figures above reflect the information as they are known at this time. I remind everyone that these are unaudited figures, and there is still about a week and a half before I will have a trial balance that will be provided to the auditors. I kind of already said that at the beginning, so that's kind of where we stand right now. Like I said, we did get some more utility bills, and I think when we were looking today, we have about 17 more electric bills that are still missing, so we're going to try and track those down so that we can get those included also. I didn't provide you, but I will just kind of give you a quick rundown on the open purchase orders also. Let's see here. For the 2016 list, it has dropped, I think it was at a million last month, but we're down to 827,000. But of that 827,000, 465,000 are related to warrant articles, so things that were passed at town meetings, so it doesn't affect the operating budget directly. And 158,000 was for that wall stabilization down at Bicentennial Park. So basically, we would only have $203,145. So that's a small number compared to what we've had in the past. I think we did a good job of making sure management did a good job of making sure that the purchase orders were very well managed at the end of the year, because I don't know, since I've been the finance director, that we only are bringing over about 203,000. So I thought that was a job well done for that. So that's what I had on the monthly financials. I don't know if you guys have any questions on those. Or
questions?
Well, no questions. It's still pretty much ongoing. Yes. I mean, the books aren't closed. So
right. I just wanted to come because we haven't been
exactly.
Here,
so we've gotten an update, and it's still being worked on. So great job. And, yeah, the open POs, that's a minimum amount compared to the past. So.
Yeah, I think last year was like 500-something thousand. So
right. Excellent work.
Okay. Maybe if you could just explain for people at home that don't understand what you're talking about when you talk about the employee separation costs and the bank buyback program, and
sure.
You put it into the fund. What is that?
Okay, both of those accounts are under the personnel administration in the general government section of the budget. Employee separation costs, we have to put money in on that line item to cover any retirements or terminations, or just someone who chooses to no longer work here and move along to another employer. So we use a formula every year. We meet with the department heads, talk to them about who could possibly retire based on their years of service and items like that, or maybe they've heard from an employee. And then we look at those individuals and we base them into a 25, 50, and 75, and 100% category. And that's how we come up with that budgeted number for that line. And then whatever's left in that line, along with whatever's in this buyback line, the town had a warrant article 2009, Fred? I think maybe for that.
It was nine.
Yeah. I believe it was in 2000. There was a warrant article at one point that said anything that was left in either of those two line items, the board would have the authority to vote to move that to the compensated leave fund that is held by the trustees. The sick buyback program, or bank buyback program, I think is officially what it's referred to now, is in regards to the union employees, if they have anything over 108 hours, I believe, or 84, depending on which union you are in, you can sell back to the town those hours at the end of the year. So it's bringing down the sick liability that the town has on the books for these employees. So it benefits the town in the end to not allow them to continue to increase the liability for their sick time. So they can sell back their sick time to cover things such as their health insurance for the year, their dental insurance, make contributions into their 457 plans, life insurance, disability, I believe. So there's a whole list in each of the contracts that allows them. Then there also is now for several years now, for the non-union employees, anything over leave time, anything over 240 hours up to 500 hours, they can sell back to the town to do some of the same things. And so those are all in the contract. So basically at the end of 2016, we had $158,911 left on the line for employee separation. So clearly we didn't have some of the retirements that we thought we might have. And then for the bank buyback, we had 12,000. So I say only because that's a small number when you're looking at the millions of dollars that we deal with, but 12,000 is a decent amount of money. So there's 12,000 left on that line. So that totaled the 171,242.
Thank you. And you come in here every month, right? With the end of the month, with the
yes.
figures for that month, how the town spent their money, how the town, what revenue the town got, and how the town spent that money, right?
Yes.
So, and then it's put right on the website, right?
Yes.
So anybody can go to the website, look, and see what we brought in for money and what we spent for money and how we spent the money. So totally transparent, right?
The reports you get are the same exact ones that are put on the website once they're distributed to the board. I put them up there. They're under documents, finance. They're right there.
Good. Thank you very much.
Rick?
You did a great job. It seems like you're bringing the year to an end, and these are, you know, it's... You're being much more effective than what's happened in the past. So thank you.
Thank you.
Well said. Okay, so I'm going to need a motion to have the balance from the employee separation cost of $158,911 $1,000.70, and the bank buyback program of $12,331.08.
I'll make that motion.
Motion by Jim.
Second
by Regina. Any questions? All in favor? Unanimous.
And do you want me to do a quick run through on the audit, or?
Sure.
Okay. So last week, maybe the week before, you should have received the 2015 audit. I did type up a memo, which I will scan through for you here in regards to the 15 audit. It just says that items related. Let's see, I'll just start at the beginning. It says, all of you should have received the 2015 audit at this time. It has also been posted on the town's website. Thought it was appropriate to provide some highlights to the audit for you. Items related to the net position of the town. The statement of the net position presents information on most of the town of Hampton's assets, deferred outflows of resources, liabilities, and deferred inflows of resources, with the difference between these amounts reported as total net position. Over time, increases or decreases in this net position may serve as a useful indicator of whether the financial condition of the town of Hampton is improving or deteriorating. The first thing that may catch many readers' eyes is that the 2014 as restated, which you will see throughout the report. The three main contributors to the restatement are below. And so it just breaks them down for you. In 2014, we became compliant with GASB statement number 34, which was related to fixed assets. When we were preparing the 2015 audit, there were several items brought to our attention and where fixed assets had been misstated. They had been included with the cost of a building and then also listed as the equipment. So I went through and basically redid all of those fixed assets to make sure that everything was correct, worked with the department heads to put everything into, break them down into smaller categories so everyone knows right where everything is, where it's located. The values of the buildings are separate than the values of the contents of the building. When they were first done, we had hired an intern to do it, and they had included the contents of the building with the cost. They were using more of like an insurance approach, and that isn't the proper way to do fixed assets. So when speaking with the auditors, we figured that that would be the best time to make the correction. So that totaled $814,165. Then the other two items were becoming compliant with GASB number 68, statement number 68, and statement number 71. GASB statement number 68 is accounting and financial reporting from pensions, which was an amendment to GASB statement number 27. And GASB statement number 71 is a pension transition for contributions made subsequent to the measurement, date, and amendment of GASB number statement number 68. So basically those two GASB statements had to do with the retirement system, the pension system. And when those in 2015 was the year in which communities were required to become in compliance with these two GASB. So for the first time in a long time, we actually were compliant with GASB's in the year that you should have been. It should be noted here that every community across the state had to do the same thing. And those two items alone caused the net pension for the town to change by $22,158,000. So those were the large contributors when people are looking at the net position. It went from $55 million down to $32 million for 2014. So that's a big jump. And I just wanted to break down for everyone what those the three contributors were to that. And it was basically the $814,000 for the GASB 34, the fixed assets, and then $22 million for the two pension system items there. So I wanted to point that out. Let's see what else here. Those were the big ones in regards to pensions. And then also the unassigned fund balance. Everyone likes to draw their attention to that. So on page 15 and page 45, there's a pretty detailed breakdown of that, but I'll just give you a quick run through here. The beginning unassigned fund balance as of 12/31 of 2014 was $5,457,505. The changes to fund balance were $1,071,023. Then the decrease in non-spendable fund balance was $94,645. And a decrease in assigned fund balance for abatement contingencies for tax abatements was $368,367. So the unassigned fund balance at the end of 2016 was, or 15, I'm sorry, was $6,991,540, which we've already reported that. That was on the 535, and when we set the tax rate, that $6 million was brought to light for the public. But I just wanted to point the breakdown there because everyone is always curious on that. So I also provided you guys with some new charts, and I can post this memo and all these charts on the website if you'd like, but it basically shows the governmental activities and what you see in the audit this year, but then it also shows how it was originally stated in 2014. So they can look right at it and see, you know, the net position in 2014 as stated in the audit was $55 million, but when it was restated it went down to $32 million, and now in 2015 the net position was $36 million. So it did increase from the $32 million, but it has decreased from what was originally reported before we were compliant with those GASBs 68 and 71 mostly. So I have all of that information in your packet, and like I said, if you would like, I can post all that on the website too. But the audit is up on the website for anyone who is interested in reading it or needs to go to sleep at night. It's whatever you choose. Regina came in today and I'm like, I just keep going through this, but not everyone feels that way probably. So every time I think something else I can analyze, but I can point out some more figures to you if you like, or you can ask questions or however you'd like. I don't want to bore everyone.
I want to bore some people just for a couple minutes.
That's fine. That's your choice.
So you noted, and I think it might be a good idea to put this up on the website if the board agrees to do so.
Sure.
But on the decrease for implementation, the 2014 restated, which is what 2014 now looks like after all the implementation that Christie has done. So that went down by, it was what, $22 million?
Yes.
$22 million. So, but if you actually go back to the 2013 financials, our statement of net position, so this was before GASB 34, 35, 68, 71, was only 962,000. So by implementation of the GASB 34, we in essence increased the statement by over $50 million. Would that be correct?
Yes.
And then in 15, we then had to do the GASB 68, which pretty much is taking your fair value, what your pensions are worth after everything you paid off. You know, what the liability of your pension, what's left. So that decreased it by almost $23
million. Yes.
But our statement of net position in 2015 still reflects an increase of $22 million. From 2013. So by what Christie has done, we have increased our net position by $22 million. So you can't just really look at 14 and 15. You got to go back a little bit further and see how all the implementation has actually benefited the town. So I just wanted to point that out. So when you look at 14 and 15, it's not that we just lost $22 million. You got to go back a few more years and you can see that it's benefited the town, and Christie has done an excellent job in making sure that we're compliant. Thank you.
Jim?
Yeah, first of all, Christy, could you explain what GASB is? People might not know what that is.
Generally Accounting Standard Board.
Right, yeah. So that General Accounting
Standards.
Right, yep. And that's what how you're supposed to run your books, right?
Yes.
According to that. And the pension one that was put in this year that decreased by $22 million, that's built on the pension unfunded liability, right?
Yes.
Right, and there's
that's our proportion of the, over the next 30 years, I believe.
30 years, mm-hmm. Pension liability.
Yes.
And that's because of things that were done, you know, up in Concord maybe, when they said you don't have to contribute, and then it went down, and they were reporting it incorrectly. But that's not $22 million we have to come up with today.
No, it's just our portion of the unfunded liability over the next 30 years.
Over
that's
the next
a calculation.
30 years, because I think people might look at that and say, whoa, wait a minute, we owe $22 million right now? That's not the case. So we're liable for $22 million right now. That's not the case. So I just think people ought to understand that. And the value of the audit to the general public is, I mean, they can look and see exactly how the money was spent, what was budgeted, expenditures, revenue, how much was left over at the end of the year, whether the budgeting process was done properly or not properly, it was done properly, whether it was accurate, and, you know, and they can see what the net position of the town is, so whether the town's in trouble or the town's not in trouble, or whether the town's in good shape. Yep. So I think it's wise to put all this on the website, and I think it's wise for people, the public, to go look at it and take a look at it and see what the town's doing, what the town's doing with their money, whether they're budgeting properly or not budgeting properly. I mean, there's a lot to be gained from the audit. And the work you've done on the GASPE requirements has been really good over the last 2 years. I mean, we are now totally compliant, yes?
Yes.
Yes, that's good.
There's another one this year, but we'll be...
Improperly stated.
And the people who want to read the audit, I recommend the MD&A, because that is a summary type of a thing, and then all of the notes okay. from the auditors. There's several of those. I think there's like 20-something. Those are good for just the general reader.
Cool. Anything?
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Mr. Chairman. And thank you, Christy, for your work. Had a chance to give this the first perusal, and we'll address this in a little bit more detail. And for the record, and I know you're overcome at this time of year, like most accountants, GASPE is Government Accounting Standard Boards, which deals with government agencies, and of course, FASB is the Federal Accounting Standard Board, which works with private institutions. Had the opportunity to review this. I'll take a couple of minutes, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Your cost to comply with GASPE was how much?
GASPE 34.
GASPE requirements you executed this year.
In 2015, the cost? There was no cost.
Yeah, you did that. Let that be recorded that for years we were told by the experts, former selectmen, former board members, none of whom are sitting here, that it was too expensive to do. And you see the swing in the net position is, they say it's $22 million. I have a different summation based on my research of the audit and interest rate reports with the pension. So great work in costing the town no money. And we heard public comment in here tonight talking about depreciation. That is a big part of this audited statement, and we'll address that. And those that have a much more clear crystal ball, when this audited financial statement is showing a $45 million depreciation of almost $100 million of assets, how you can pick and choose which ones are which and have that crystal ball is not something that I think is the professional standard, nor at the state. We rely on the infrastructure that we make those decisions in those kind of statements. But back to the GASPE. Great work. And again, the statement of net position answered Jim's question. And this is probably one of the most important, probably the most important document that comes out from the town. This is the snapshot. This is not, it's fairly etched in stone of the financial position of this company, this corporation, which is the town of Hampton, which was incorporated in 1639. So soon to be a 400-year-old corporation. There aren't many around. There's Toby and Merrill. There's Morelli's. Maybe the Bridles were raking leaves down at the salt marsh back then, but there's not many. And it's one heck of a corporation. You don't hear it much, and it's very well led. But this audited financial statement lends credence to that. And there aren't any companies like this in Hampton. And the more the merrier. There's some very, very fine companies. Business owners are in the audience tonight. The Prestons, Mr. Rage, others, municipal employees. But this is one heck of a corporation, and that's from the accounting standpoint, and from the operations, of course, it has no peer. The net position is a statement that represents the information on the town of Hampton's assets, deferred outflows of resources, liabilities, and deferred inflows of resources, with the difference between these amounts is the total net position. So we have a $22 million net position. that's money in the bank, an asset with a little bit of wobble in there, but as well as they can predict. And there might be 10 or 15 points off, but it's $22 million in the plus. And as I say again, there aren't too many corporations in this town that have that. And you never hear that from those that sometimes come in and would argue otherwise. I think that's an important thing to get out there. And Jim was highlighting on that. And again, we looked at 3 and 4 years ago, and we had no idea what our net position was in this town. We said it's under $1 million. Then we say it's $55 million. Now we're getting close. We're getting into the black. We're not there yet. I don't have full confidence that this is exact, and I'll talk about that a little later. I think our pension liability is off by about $3 million by what the New Hampshire Retirement has declared as the new rate in their earnings last year. But now we're getting into the black, and we can really see the strength. And Christy, you're the one that did this. And how many years have you been the director?
It was 2 years in
May. 2 years. In 2 years, you've come in and done this, and it's nothing short of remarkable. The New Hampshire Retirement is the one that's driving this. Two-thirds of our pension contribution for our Class 1 and Class 2 employees is to make up that liability. People squander or squabble about this. The Social Security liability makes our pension plan in New Hampshire look like child's play. The Medicare that many people enjoy in this town is $100 trillion out of debt. It makes our pension challenges look minuscule compared to the federal level. The difference is that people in New Hampshire are actually doing something about it, and they're actually getting out their wallet and getting out their purse and doing something about it. So that contribution level we have is taxpayers honoring their commitment, picking up the slack when the state worked moved away from it. And Jim and others were up there, and Ben Moore, Rusty, that made this happen. And it's very important, and I don't want to bore anybody, but I think every year I go over this, and it's one of the most important documents that we can get over, and it's factual, and it's audited, and it's not out of ignorance, and it's by CPAs. These folks do our school system as well, is that correct? Thank you.
At least last year, I know they did. I assume they're still doing it.
Pardon me?
They did it last year for sure, because okay. I know, but I assume it. They're still the auditors.
And again, we talked about the net position that's been restated. I want to speak to the capital assets. There's a historical cost of close to $100 million that are assets that were part of that GASB reset, that calculation that you did. Never been done before. You did it for nothing. We had a public speaker, and I'm going to come back to it. Again, he spent several minutes talking about it. He has a clear crystal ball that he knows that those pipes don't need to be replaced. The auditors for the town of Hampton assert in this document that we have $50 million of depreciation. They're not making that up. It's an expense. It's not addressed in capital improvements. If you look at our bond schedule, you'll see fire stations, you'll see wastewater treatment, you'll see pump stations, you'll see X, you'll see Y, you'll see Z. You'll see, as Jim has talked about up here and others on Lafayette Road, we have pipes that have no tops. Pipes that have no tops. So we have $50 million of capital assets that have rotted. The GASB requirement ensures that we don't play games and that bondholders and people that assess our creditworthiness know that we are taking that matter seriously. So 50% of our capital assets have been depreciated fully, and we can't escape that. The pipes that are leaking, that threaten our way of life and our tax base and our income, are part of that $50 million that are now junk. And we must protect ourselves from that. So I wanted to respond to the public comments, and I wanted to back that up with factual data by certified accountants, public accountants, CPAs, and our audited financial statements. The long-term debt, we're very well within our limit of that. We can borrow up to $83 million, and our borrowing is at 26% of the maximum allowable. So you at home, when you're looking at your warrant articles this year, that $50 million of capital assets that have been depreciated, when you're looking at different expenditures and looking at your wallet, it's your town, it's your decision. We're well within our bonding capability required by state law, pardon me, and that may help you in making any decisions and looking at the big picture in terms of how healthy this corporation is in terms of its finances. And pardon me if I'm going on too long, but I think this is important information for the public to hear. Again, the $100 million assets, the restatement. I want to emphasize that the Public Works budget, both sanitation and the highway department, that really is the combined, those two, that is in terms of when you exclude health insurance from the general government, that is the dog wagging the tail in this, in terms of our capital assets, our depreciation, and really what propels our budget dollar. Revenues look great. Expenses look great. Our borrowing limit looks great. There's a typo on page 24. Christy and I have already talked about that. And again, Jerry Zanoy's comments tonight. We have $80 million that are being depreciated. We have $14 million that are not being depreciated. This is on page 27. Total capital assets that are not being depreciated is almost $15 million, 14.2. We have $80 million that are being depreciated. Our net book of all capital assets, including the 14, is down to $49 million. We've got one heck of a capital improvements challenge, one heck of a infrastructure depreciation and erosion and collapsing problem. How we have dealt with it in the past is how, unfortunately, we're dealing with it now. Is when it's broken, we fix it. And that's not good science, but that's what we're doing. And we're not unlike a lot of other corporations or how a lot of other people run their own homes. Christy, on page 29, you did some various bond refundings, $5.4 million. You went from a much more exorbitant rate down to 2.15. You executed that. Is that correct?
Yes, in 2014.
Yep. 2014. Could you tell us a little bit about that and how much money you saved the town when you did it?
I believe it was right in the $436,000 process. The Mike had actually started that right before he left, so I picked up the baton on that one and finished it off. But we saved about $436,000. We took all of the bonds that were non-SRF that we had left on the books and refinanced all of those so that we would have the lower interest rate.
SRF.
It's from the State Revolving Fund Loan
Okay.
Program.
Just because when you give, you know, when we say acronyms, people don't at home say, what the heck is she talking about?
Most of the debt, actually all the debt now, but prior to that, not all of the debt was under the State Revolving Fund Loan Program, which tends to have a lower interest rate. And so when we refinanced them, we got a lower interest rate and ended up saving about $436,000 on
Wonderful.
Those.
Great
that
work.
Was a long time ago.
Great work. And what was the bank that provided that for us? Do you remember?
I do not. Okay. Not off the top of my head, sorry.
Less important. But we look at the general obligations. We talk about infrastructure requirements. We talk about that pipe that's gone bad. I want to go back to 1999, the wastewater treatment plant. We look at SRF. We look at wastewater treatment plant upgrade. 2005, Kings Highway, $4.7 million in 2005, beach infrastructure, $1.7 million, wastewater treatment plant, $1.3 million. We look at recycling equipment, $1.2 million in 2011. We look at fire station, $5.16 million in 2013. We wait till the last minute. Fire stations, you can't even get a fire truck in and out. We do it at the last minute, and we go ahead and do that. That's another example of the depreciation of the low standards that we get to. Without that really well-executed capital improvement plan. And again, I want to speak to what Jerry said. And Jerry, I commend Jerry for doing his research as he sees it. He comes in here, and I just wanted to offer this other scenario backed up. The Church Street pumping station, $3.2 million. Mr. Welch, you want to shed a little light on how that came to fruition? It was well known, and then it was about to break. Go ahead. I'll give you the floor, please.
It was well known. It was kicked down the road for quite a number of years because nobody really wanted to get into redoing the station. It was a very bad project, a very difficult project. I believe that the original estimate we came in with was $7.5 million to replace it, and we more than have that to actually do the work. So we saved a lot of money, and a lot of that work was done in-house.
Right, thank you. And that was at the state where it was perilous in terms of that being able to perform its function.
It was in the process of complete failure.
Thank you very much, sir. We look at the contributions for our Group 1 and Group 2. We received those contribution numbers from the state. Is that correct?
Yes.
Those are mandated.
Yep.
The New Hampshire trustees have a rate of return that's been published. It doesn't coincide with what the audit says. I think there needs to be some tweaking. But the unfunded liability is the difference between current assets and the value of benefits already accrued. The unfunded liability, which will be paid off through 2039, accounts for more than two-thirds, or 66%, of what we pay for our Group 1 and Group 2 employees. So we're making up for past omissions, past sins. It's not that our employees are getting paid anymore. It's just other people have walked away from the obligation. And I commend the state of New Hampshire. I commend taxpayers for grabbing the bull by the horns, unlike Washington, unlike Concord, that walked away from this. And taxpayers right here are the ones that are protecting that pension and their viability. And it's precious. It's a long-term liability. I don't know if I'm going to be around here in 2039. Fred, you probably will be. But it's a great stab making this happen. And pardon me for going on just a little bit longer, Mr. Chairman. The actuarial assumptions on the pension, and I want to bring this out to the public, they are declaring in this audited statement that they are using 7.75. The one-year average for last year was 3%. The Board of Trustees has gone down to 7.25%. On page 35, it talks about the math on this, and we don't need an answer tonight, but when you drop down to 6.75, it's $28 million is the liability. The 7.75 is 21. We're looking at 7.25 or lower. I mean, it could go higher, but as we most recently report, there's a $3 million wobble in what they're reporting on this audited statement. And if you grab that concept, Christy, I would like you to share that with the auditors, and maybe they can restate the net position, because I don't think it's accurate, and I think it sucks up the difference between what they're asserting that we gained and what is actually boots on the ground with that number. And we don't need to elaborate it unless somebody wants to pick up that trumpet, but I see that as a discrepancy. I see that it's based in fact, and that is from the May 16 NHRS, New Hampshire Retirement System Trustees Lower, the assumed rate of return. The one-year rate was 3.5%, so it's gone down. It hasn't performed that well. Mr. Silberdick's in the house. Perhaps they could use his talent. He's done four, five, six times what they've performed most recently. That's what I have. It's a document that's worth study. It's a very impressive corporation. It's a very impressive bunch of operators, and it's a very impressive command element that you lead, Mr. Welch and Mr. Chairman. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Yeah. Mr. Welch, are you satisfied with the audit?
I'm very pleased with the audit. There's always room for improvement in anything you do, and we try to look for that improvement and put it into effect the following year. That's exactly what we are trying to do now.
Thank you again. Thank you.
I think we're all set.
Rusty.
Yep.
Just one thing.
Follow up. Go ahead.
What percent unassigned fund balance. What percent is that at now? It's about
9.88. It was when we set the tax rate.
Okay,
it was at 9.88%.
And what did they want it to be at?
They want it above 5. 5 is the minimum. Meaning DRA, okay. Department of Revenue Administration.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. They recommend their minimum unassigned fund balance, or their retention, is 5%, and it goes up as high as 17. And when we set the tax rate, we were at, I grabbed the wrong year. We were at 9.88%, I believe. I grabbed the wrong year, so, okay. But I'm pretty sure it was 9.88 when I looked at it earlier today.
Okay, so we're well within where we should be, but we could be a lot better.
Yeah, you could be higher, yes.
Okay. Thank you.
And then one last thing I had passed around tonight, too, just to make sure I get back. You guys can give to Fred the default budget, which you had approved, but we have to have it signed. So when we post the warrant, it's hopefully this week it'll have a... You got it. Okay. I'll grab it. Bring it with me. All right.
Thank you very much, Christy.
Fred, do you want to
next one up is Charlie Preston.
I stopped so I could listen.
Oh. Not long time, a lot of fun.
Hey, Charlie. How you doing? Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the appointment. I'm asking for a small thing that could, I think, could turn out to be huge, and for little or no money. I would if you give me a brief on the community announcement. Again, mention the license plates. If people haven't registered this month, or if they're going to register next month, to consider the state parks plate, because for $85 they can pick up about 83 days of free parking on the whole coast. It would help the businesses down the beach and right up the coast of New Hampshire. I'm here to request something that I believe will accomplish goals of the master plan. This could help alleviate traffic with small costs, and I believe signage. A couple of examples where signage worked with little costs were making leaded streets at the beach down streets to curtail cruising. Another example was the four-way stop sign at the intersection of Brown Ave and 101. I don't recall any costly studies to implement these improvements. What I am proposing is to have you take action or make a recommendation to make the back northwest corner gate of the town's Ashworth Ave lot an exit-only gate. And I don't know if you've had a chance to see that at all in the last couple of weeks, but it's the gate in the back of the lot, northwest corner. It's right next to the police station gate. It's across the street from the fire station and the precinct. It doesn't line up with anybody, so it's not direct. I firmly believe the gains far outweigh any possible losses. If there was a concern of illegal entry, maybe pay and display or some sort of parking should be considered. Maybe even split the lot with kiosks. I touched with Diana briefly on that in her office a couple last week. I'm not sure of the present operations or if any changes are being considered by Parks and Rec Department. By allowing incremental exits of the Ashworth Ave lot, this keeps all traffic headed north, presently exiting this lot, from going from the right lane in Ashworth Ave to the left lane within a block, only to go to G Street, where the whole street queues up, where the top of G Street and Ocean Boulevard is probably one of the heaviest pedestrian crosswalks in the town, followed by F, E, and D Street crosswalks. Those are the four busiest crosswalks in town. All during the high traffic and high pedestrian times. Plus, at least, there's 11 crosswalks from the top of G Street to get to 101. By doing this, I believe you will help alleviate both traffic congestion and motor vehicle pedestrian interaction. This is something that is common sense, without much cost, and friendly to both residents and visiting guests. Thank you for consideration, and hopefully you can take action or give direction to our Parks and Recs Department. I asked the chief, you know, if he would comment, and I also noticed we have an expert witness, that I would say he's a dual commissioner, a commissioner of the Village District and a commissioner of the HBAC. He also owns property at the top of G Street and the bottom of G Street, runs great businesses. Back at you, Mr. Bean, on the family business.
Sure.
And all, Chuck also runs the Rexall Drugs. So he's right in the heart of all this. And I think he'd be a great expert witness if the chief, and I did call the fire chief, and I didn't see anything because if cars queue here, it's all inside the lot. So there's no, I don't think you'd have any problem at all. And if it works, it's a win-win for everybody. You know, if it doesn't work, and you can close the gate. But I firmly believe that this will work. If they'd like to comment on it, that's you could ask them. The other thing I wanted to touch on, and I'll make it very brief. I'm not exactly sure why we plow the Ashworth Ave lot while it remains locked. I'd like to see in the future here if we could have the town, the rec department, the village district, public works, the state, and the general public to discuss safe off-street, off-season winter parking. As of today, the emergency snow ban at the beach has been enforced for 69 days for maybe 3 or 4 times that were necessary. This sure doesn't sound user-friendly to both beach residences and businesses. Let's get together and improve all aspects of the off-season parking. This could improve both parking and snow removal for public works. Let's get everybody to the table and work together. We can make this a much better situation and help all involved parties. Thank you very much. I would like to think that you would consider taking some action on that exit. I think it's a win-win. And maybe some other people will comment. If you have any questions, I'd glad feel free.
I know exactly what you're talking about down on Brownout. And on that note, I'd like to maybe hear from the chief of police since he's here, Commissioner Rage, and also Parks and Rec director is here as well. So maybe on some additional, I think that one of the concerns might be, Mr. Welch, that there's be a lot of entrances, exits in one area of Brown Ave, because we have the fire department, we have the precinct parking lot, we have the police station, and we would have a fourth one. Yeah. But maybe like certain hours or something like that. And then I was confused on what you said as far as the side streets. You're talking about A, B, C. Did you say switching the directions or something?
No, what I said was changes that have been made that didn't cost the town any money, just signage, switching it around. They made a bunch of the leaded streets, and this is done seasonally. The chief would tell you exactly how many streets it is, and they make them all downs. And that was done to try to stop the cruising, and it worked. You know, a bunch of people got together. They had a summit on the porch. I believe it was on M Street. I believe it was at Dick's house. And they sat down and worked. Brown Ave, I mean, most people here remember Brown Ave and 101 was dangerous. They made it a four-way stop. And I don't think any of us liked it at first because it was change, but it worked. You know, people used to come down before there was a stop sign there, and they'd be going up Highland Ave at 30, 40 miles an hour. You know, and it's been a traffic calm. We're all used to it now, and it's the way it works. You know, I don't think the fire chief would tell us, I don't see many accidents. I live right down the street. So this is something, and I agree with you, there's a lot happening there as far as there, but the whole trick to this is the cars that are going to queue are queuing inside the town lot. I did come before this board, I'm not sure exactly what year, and I tried to get the board to consider making an entrance and an exit based on they would make more revenue, and I understand there was costs associated with moving the shed, with their parking operations, and they've got it set up that way. So this was a way to take some baby steps and say, let's just do this on the exit only, because it keeps people off the boulevard, which is alleviating traffic.
My only concern is, and we'll have the chief come up and the others if they want, but is when you have your high times of traffic and you stop blocking Brown Ave and loading Brown Ave up, and then you need to get vehicles in or off the beach, emergency vehicles. You've taken their one road to get off the beach, and you've now put a bunch of cars in there. And where you have both the police and fire station coming out on that same road at that one time, when it is traffic, and I've been down there many times myself,
yeah,
and I've gone through the traffic on Brown Ave, and it's when you get traffic both ways tied up, it can be very difficult.
And I agree. There's a few. We could probably count the times on Brown Ave on where it backs up everywhere, and it's backed up on every street in that beach on those same days that we're talking about. But You know, you have to remember, this is an incremental release. This isn't a mass evacuation. This is a car leaving when they leave. It might be one, might be not be another one for 5 minutes. It might not be another one for an hour. This isn't like people getting lined. And another thing, a mass evacuation, Rusty, could actually work at times where if the chief decides that he doesn't want any more people on Ashworth Ave because there's an accident on the bridge, he can turn around to Parks and say, close the gate on Ashworth and send them all out. You know, you have that flexibility. But obviously, I'd like to hear from others.
Any other questions from the board first? And we'll bring the chief up.
This has got a lot of different parts to it. I'm just going to speak to the public safety issues, more the traffic control issues. There is merit to what Charlie's saying, that on those peak periods, when somebody, say it's somebody that's from uptown, they park down in front of the PD in the municipal lot, when they go to leave right now, they have to go south on Ashworth Ave, and the closest up street is G Street. Now, Charlie is right with his assertion that G Street is probably one of the busiest crosswalks up on Ocean Boulevard. We have a standing practice for the officers working in that area to make sure that they dump out G Street traffic, primarily for emergency functions for the fire department, that if they have to get up to the front, that's their primary route that they're going to take to the front of the casino. So trying to keep that open is a difficult task. We have to assign officers there sometimes for hour-long periods to accomplish that task. And it's still battling just because the cars keep coming out of the lots between the private lots north of there and the municipal lot. Now, how many cars would utilize Brown Ave? I don't know. That's hard to say. How many people from town or would know about that back route of Brown Ave would actually utilize that? That's hard to put a barometer on. Would it bleed some of the traffic off of Ocean Boulevard? I think during the peak periods it may. The concern about backing up on Brown Ave as we speak, usually the backups on Brown Ave is that incoming traffic coming off of 101, making it down to Ashworth Avenue. In the reverse, I don't think I've ever seen in my time in Hampton PD with Brown Ave backed up in the opposite direction where people are trying to exit. I haven't witnessed that. I'm not saying it's never happened, but not enough frequency for me to have ever seen in, you know, 20-some-odd years with the Hampton Police Department. The other issues you're going to run into, though, are manning that gate. Charlie and I have talked about that, you know, his belief is just signs would work. I don't agree with that. I think, you know, people would take advantage of that coming in from the other way, not just using it as an exit, but pulling in, and that's going to be difficult for the rec department to manage with their current configuration, because there's somebody inside the shed and usually up somebody up by the other gate managing that when they get full. Now you're going to have to add staffing to manage that side gate, so that's the downside to it. So I think there's a lot of discussion that needs to be, you know, happen before we make any changes to it, but I think it's worth considering.
Question for the chief.
Thank you. One of the advantages of the Village District parking lot is a lot of people in the casino will park there and they'll shoot right out Brown Ave. I don't know if it's a full-time job of having that gate there, but I think it could come in handy on nights of the casino and on fireworks night. You could put those spikes there so they could only go out. That could be an option. So you wouldn't have to have a manning it there. You could have decide that this is the right time to open that gate. Signage, easiest way to 95. I think it makes a huge difference. They're not just blocking I Street because I Street is full. G Street, because G Street is full. They're going to I Street, and they're filling I Street. So if you could eliminate some of the, on those busy nights, of getting people out. During the day, I don't know if it's necessary, but there's a lot of times that I would think that who's ever running the parking lot could make that decision and to try it, and it might be perfect. And as Charlie said, if it doesn't work, you close the gate. But I don't think it's a lot of money that's going to affect. And I also think we do need more signage of getting people. There's a small sign on Ashworth Avenue showing the signs of 95, but maybe some better signage to move some of those people out. It's amazing how many people don't know they can go out that way, and it would make a huge difference down the beach. So I think this is a great idea. I'm not for it 100%, but I'm more for it than I'm against it.
Okay.
Hi again. I just want to go on record saying I'm not opposed to Charlie's idea at all, but I do have concerns, being the person that runs the lots, that people sneaking in type thing. If we did implement something like this, I think it should be in the evening for sure, because there's no way, I fear for the safety of our people, having someone out there without a shed at that gate, having people come in and out. It's a logistics problem, I think, for us. We do open the gate on Wednesday nights for firecrackers to let people out. But I think during the day when cars are coming down Brown Ave, the problem for us is we're on the wrong side of the street. It's easy to get out of the parking lot, the Hampton Beach Village District, and just drive right through. But we'd have to cross traffic coming through, and that might back up people in the parking lot as well. So that's why I think if something like this were to be implemented, in the evenings, maybe we could maybe open that gate. But I do like Chuck Rage's idea, or Charlie's idea, or whoever came up with it, about the strip there. I too don't know how much it costs, but that would be a great way to keep people from coming through that gate during the day. But that's just a logistics. I don't have the manpower really to put two people on in that parking lot right now with the amount of employees that I'll have and the money that I have for paying them. But it's not a bad idea if we could work it out in the evenings.
You know, I agree with all three, and Charlie, partially, that it's a good idea. I don't agree with the spikes, because there are a lot of stupid drivers. They're going to drive over it, and all of a sudden they're going to want the town to pay for their tires, you know? But I do agree with you, Diana, that if we open the gate during the day, people are going to be trying to get in there, mm-hmm. no matter whether you have an exit or not. So you're going to have to put somebody out there.
And right, and I don't want someone out there collecting
without a shed,
money,
yeah.
you know,
yeah.
right out there in the public.
Right. It's but, I mean, I agree with that a discussion can be had on this, that the idea mm-hmm. can stay open, that a trial period or maybe evenings and stuff can do it and see what happens and go from there. I mean, I'm not opposed to the idea at all.
Rick?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think if it has the approval of the police chief, that's what I'd be looking for, and possibly to do it as a trial situation.
You have to be specific, though, in what you're asking me to do, though. That's the only thing.
Like, you already do it on firework night?
We do it on some Wednesdays when it's really packed down there on firework night.
Yeah, I just need the formal chop from both Fred and the police chief and the fire department, all three of them.
So why don't we look at it?
Okay.
And you got plenty of time between now and summer, obviously.
And if I could,
it's a good time to bring it up now, obviously.
Exactly. You know, it's one of those issues. It's got to come up sometime.
Yep.
One thing I can mention, when you get a chance to look at it, now when you look at that lot, it doesn't line up with any. Well, there's a row of head-in spaces towards the police station. What would be the traffic lane where people would queue exiting, and I stress incremental exits, line straight up with the gate, and then there's another row of spaces that run parallel to the ones up to the police station. So I really think, while we pretty much all agree with the concept, and we might have a little bit of differences on manning, I honestly think it can be done without manning, and I think, you know, three said no, but what my point is, look at it. You know, we all go into this with an open mind, and because I think most people are pretty good, and I think things have changed down that beach, and they're getting for the better. I don't think it's ever looked better at that beach. And this is within less than 100 feet of a beautiful police station and fire station, and I think most people comply with the law. And I think when you have emergency vehicles, those big red trucks with them sirens and flashing lights, most people they pop the C's for those guys. So I think that works. So if you look at it, and I'd just like to say, you know, the signage is the whole key, and I think it can be done without people. If you look, when you face that gate from, say, the precinct parking lot, You take the first space alongside, you could probably put two jersey barriers and put them in a straight row, and you could have some kids from the high school, I'd gladly go down and help them, and just paint one way with big arrows on them, and you can make some nice decorative thing with some art students, and we can make this work without spending a lot of money. And, and the other thing I mentioned to Diana, and she, and this was just in her office last week, and she never had, she said nobody else had actually brought it up, was we talked about kiosks and meters, and she said she had looked into it and it was very expensive. And I said, but did you ever look into cutting that lot where you could use this gate and have an access? Because I was pushing for access and an exit on Brown Ave because it keeps everybody off the boulevard and G Street. You could actually cut part of that lot off and put the kiosks in because those are what's happening everywhere in the world today. And that could be done with just a couple of kiosks. And that's just another consideration down the road. But I think this exit thing that I'm talking will work. And take a look. I appreciate your time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Charlie. We'll take a look at it.
Thank you.
All right. Next one is trustee of the trust funds. Review of this year's end numbers.
I think I have one too for the record. Okay. Yes, I think you sent one up. Thank you.
I have one, but I'll take another one.
Let me have one more.
Thank you.
I get my record.
So you're sticking with your diet, huh?
I am. been hanging in there. Just to give you a, we met last Tuesday. Go over the year end, and for the quarter, which ended December 31st, it was a very up and down period, especially with the election. And right before President Trump was elected, the market took a real dip, and then the Trump bump occurred, and stock market rose closer to Dow Jones, close to 20,000. And we recovered. It started out to be a bad period and wound up with a $78,000 gain for the quarter. But for the year, we finished up with $2 million gain, which was quite good. We did receive some money from the town from the sale of property. And we're right now, I believe, at an all-time high as far as the money invested. We generated $693,000 for the town, which is a very good return. And this year we're projecting, we've given a budget figure of 700. It's more closer to 713 is what we think we'll come in at. We are looking at, continuing to look at the portfolio to see what we can do to improve it. Our bonds, as interest rates will rise, we bought some bonds at very favorable prices. And bond prices will drop because the yields will rise, but we're holding those to maturity, so it really won't affect us. And we bought most of those bonds at a discount. Over the last 5 years, we've had a gain of $6.6 million, and over the last 3 years, $3 million. We had 11% gain for this year, which is frankly really good. I can't say the same thing for my own personal portfolio, which has a lot of risk to it, but anyway, the common capital reserves, which tend to be a little more conservatively invested in case need to liquidate some of the funds with withdrawals, so we keep those into smaller valued, more in bonds and. There was a slight loss for the last 3 months. We had a $43,000 gain for the year. And those are always immediately available for the town. So the nature of the investments are short-term in nature. And the common trust funds, again, we have those. Skip the page. We made $1,500 for the quarter, and we had $39,000 for the year, a 7% gain, which is pretty good. those don't have as much a demand for withdrawals as some library, et cetera, we deal with, but for the most part, the funds stay there. And then the school, we had, again, very conservative investments because of their periodic requirements for disbursements of funds or special ed or whatever they might need. So, again, we had about a 2.9%. These investments are very conservatively managed. They're not, they're short term in nature, so their returns are going to be short term. So, the trustees were pleased with the performance of the advisor, and we're continuing to look forward to a good 2017. Happy to answer any questions.
Questions for the trustees? Gina?
So you said our overall return was about 11%?
Yeah.
Yep, no questions. Good job. Great job. Thank you.
Can't argue with success.
No.
Very good. You can be well diversified.
Yeah, we're 40% equity, 60% fixed income.
Over the NHRS.
Yeah. We're happy to do that. Cut that unfunded liability down.
Bill.
You're doing 350% better than the brain surgeons at the New Hampshire Retirement System, Norm. Congratulations on your success. I know it's a long road. It's a tough market, and you've done very well. Thank you.
Thank you.
So what's your crystal ball tell you for the next year?
Well,
I
think we have to give the new president an opportunity to implement his agenda. And if he implements his agenda, which would reflect itself in lower tax rate, the recapture of foreign funds, and addressing the long-term $18-19 trillion deficit that we have, and if he's able to at least take some steps in that direction, and more jobs coming back, and he certainly sounds like a tough guy wanting to get this done, it could be a real boon to the American economy, to the quality of jobs that will be in this country. And I'm very personally very optimistic and wish the new administration all the best for all Americans, including our town. Yeah. Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next thing we have is the town manager's report.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board. With the coming changes in the state's computer system, I'd like folks to make note that the town clerk's office will be closed on Friday, February 17th through February 21st, 2017. Systems will be down, so that basically they won't be able to do anything on the computer system at all with the state. So they're going to close and do their other work if necessary, but they will just not be there for people at the window. The selectmen have received a copy of the released proposed county budget for 2017. The total budget sums requested are $81,006,766. That's an increase of only $310,386 over the current year, or the past year, excuse me. We just changed years again. It keeps us guessing because we're working in two parallel systems. The town has been served with an administrative order from the Department of Environmental Services requiring the town to replace the Church Street sewer force mains via an overland route by December 1st, 2017. Please make note to attend the deliberative session of the annual town meeting on Saturday, February 4th, starting at 8:30 a.m. at the Winnicunda High School. This session of the annual town meeting will establish the final language of the warrant articles that you will vote on at the annual town election on March 14th. So it's extremely important that people show up. In addition to that, Mr. Chairman, our learned precinct commissioners, and I noticed they're gone, have invited our department heads to their next meeting to explain the warrant articles. So their next meeting of the commission, which will be February 8th, at the commission meeting room down at the beach. Our department heads are going to be coming down to work with the commissioners and explain the warrant articles that are out there.
Very good.
Also, we've received a communication from the Coalition Communities, of which we are a member, dealing with a bill that's coming up in the legislature, CONCON 7, which would change the basis for educational costs. It would make the legislature the sole responsibility for determining educational costs to schools. It would, the attempt is by constitutional amendment to remove the courts and everyone else from that particular situation. So the legislature would be the beginning and final end of that process. The committee is concerned that under certain circumstances that may lead to donor towns again, which is, of course, nobody wants to deal with at this point in time. Town council's here, and I'll sort of lead into this. He may want to have something to say about it again. We have been dealing with the Aquarian Water Company and various things that have been going on with them because of rate increases, particularly WICA charges. We've asked them a lot of questions, of which we have received zero answers. We have filed a request on behalf of the town for a hearing with the Public Utilities Commission to try to get those answers. And the town of Northampton is joining with us in that request, which is something that should happen so that everybody can be on the same level ground. The last thing I've got, we received what I would call some criticism at the Budget Committee meetings dealing with the $50,000 appropriation we have for the MS4 storm water requirements of the federal government, which at the time of the budget hearings had not been issued, and we have heard that will probably never be issued by some folks. I just want them to know that I received the 282 pages of that set of regulations on Friday. It is the most comprehensive set of regulations I have seen in years. They are released on the 18th. I have a feeling that's a magic date because the inauguration was on the 20th, and new federal regulations have been stopped as of the 20th. So we've just sort of made it under the door, so to speak. This is a beginning cost of at least $50,000 a year, and my suspicion is it's going to end up in the hundreds of thousands of dollars per year to implement these regulations forever until they're repealed. I just want people to know they're actually here, and we do have a copy of them. And I think Mark wants to sort of follow up on my report with something for you because of the WICA charges with the
water company.
Yes, the WICA charge is a pilot program that was first initiated at the Public Utilities Commission at their general rate case in 2008. It remains a pilot program, and what happens is every year the Aquarian Water Company is able to come to the commission, show the capital expenditures that it has incurred from September 30th of the prior year to September 30th of the year in question, and seek a surcharge to impose on customers in order to pay for that those improvements over time in a specific amount, which is determined utilizing a specified rate of return. And especially through the assistance this year of Selectman Barnes, we have undertaken an in-depth analysis of whether Aquarian Water Company is achieving more than its rate of return that's been authorized, a return on equity, and also whether or not the company is paying off its debt as opposed to paying large dividends to its shareholders. And as a result, we have gone beyond the usual inquiries to ask important questions in this particular year in which the WICA expenditures are approximately 40% more this year than in prior years. It's a very important task. It's very involves some specialized knowledge that we're fortunate to have through Selectman Barnes. And as a result, we asked some important questions in a very compressed time frame of Aquarian. And at the end of the short time period in which we had to give our recommendations, we set forth very specific types of data that we wish to receive, some of which already is Aquarian admits is in existence, such as independent audit data. We asked that the Public Utilities Commission not approve the WICA surcharge until this information could be received and evaluated, and not approve undertaking of future projects that would be charged under the WICA program. The Commission, however, just a few days ago decided that on the 13th that yes, we are going to allow this surcharge to go forward, and where they said they would only require a particular type of information, one small subset of what we were asking for, to be required of Aquarian. And so this order is supposed to go into effect at the end of this week if we did not file by today certain comments. And our comments today were how important it was for the type of information we have requested to be provided, that the Commission should require that this information be produced first, which it hasn't done. And the Northampton Water Commissioners met today and concurred with our comments and have filed those today with the Commission. So by the end of this week, we're expecting an order of the Commission in response to those comments. Hopefully they'll change their approach.
Virginia, you have?
Yeah, I would like to say that I think that if they don't change their approach and just push it off, like I guess is how they've done it since 2008 or whenever they first implemented this WICA program, that we need to get this, and we need to get this information out there, and we need to let people know what's going on, because we're 75%.
We are.
Of their customers. And now Northampton, that brings it up to
probably 90%.
90%. So I've never heard of a corporation or a company that has 90% of their clients unsatisfied and can get away with not addressing the issues. So I think, you know, we give them their time, whatever the 20, the, sometime this week we'll probably hear.
Later this week, yes.
And I think that if it's okay with this board, and I guess we could maybe decide that next meeting, that if they don't and they just push it off, push it under the rug, then we go to Max, we go to everyone we know, and we get this, we say, this is what we've requested, and we've been ignored, and they want to charge, they want to throw in almost another $1 million of WICA expenses for 2017. They want to repaint a water tower that I like to know the last time the work's been done on that, because they say it's supposed to be 10 to 25 years. Well, I doubt it's been 25 years. So is that project really necessary? Things like that. You know, people are getting mad at us because we want to replace pipes that are broken. But we're going to let Aquarian get away with doing this, and we don't have any substantiation of how they're spending this money. I truly feel that until we get an audited report from independent auditors, that they can't justify paying shareholders $1.3 million. What we pay them, they're given to their shareholders in Australia. Not right. Bottom line. We can't let this go anymore. We can't. We gotta do something. If they don't listen to us, then we gotta tell our reps, we gotta tell our state senator, and we gotta get it out there. Can't go on any longer. We're getting ripped off. Bottom line.
Jim?
No, I'm set.
Go. Regina, thanks for your diligence and your hard work on this issue. I know you've grabbed it, the bull by the horns, so thank you for all of your research. And I know that it extends past here, and there's national conferences, and you're making liaison with national-level platforms to advance our causes, and thank you. And the Esquire is right there with you, and you're both doing a great job. Thank you. Rick?
It sounds good, but I don't have much faith that much will happen. I've watched this over and over and over again, and as long as it's not costing any money.
Well, I agree, but I think we have somebody now that's actually looking at it, somebody that's got a good eye on it, somebody we haven't had that opportunity to have before, and somebody that's shown an interest in finding out what's wrong and how we can correct it. And as you said, 75% of these customers of theirs come from Hampton. That's 75% of it. And there's a lot of Hampton that doesn't have Hampton water. And they've been looking to put add different areas on in other communities, and they can't supply us with what the water is they have now. They're having a hard time supplying the 75% of Hampton that, or 75% of their customers. And there are some people that don't have water, you know, don't have that opportunity to have town water.
And not all of Northampton does either.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So I think you guys have done an excellent job. I commend the work you put into it. Keep after them. Keep it going. And for their ratepayers and our taxpayers, I think we need to make sure that we're protecting them.
Has the town of Rye done anything so far?
They are finally beginning to show up at meetings where these issues are being discussed. Previously, we have reached out to them, and there has not been much contact, but that's starting to change now, thankfully.
Problem is, it's only Jenna's Beach part of Rye.
Yes.
Oh, Rye has their own water district also.
Right.
And Jenna's Beach is only the part that belongs to the Hampton Water
Company. Is Mrs. Wolseley still on the board of the water department?
I don't believe so.
It's the last time she was the only one that went all the way up to testify in favor of the water company. Yeah. Has anyone been going up to testify in favor of the water company?
They've been holding quarterly meetings actually at our place where we've been right there and have been inviting the other communities to come, and they have come.
Great. Thank you.
Okay. Anything else for the town manager? Any questions for the town manager? Do you have any more in your report?
No, I'm done, Mr. Chairman.
All right. Any questions?
Just you mentioned on the state giving us the letter about the Church Street, and I just want to reply to the person that made public comment on that there are facts out there.
Yes.
All right. I respect the opinion of that person, but there are facts, and the DPW has put out facts, so I don't want the public to think that there are no facts. All right. There are facts, and you can find those on the website and everything, and the public should look at the facts and make up their own mind on the facts.
Yes.
I'd like to add one thing to what Jim said, and also about Fred's reminder of the deliberative session, February 4th at the high school, 8:30 in the morning. Very long day, but as a person that lives in town, you really want to know what the real deal is on all these warrant articles, and you can hear what one person says over here, one person says over there. Come to town meeting. It's all going to be explained. Like Jim says, you'll have access to all the facts, and we really need to get a representative portion of the town at the deliberative session on February 4th.
Thank you.
Question.
People all from all parts of the town, all age groups, everything. Come, listen, decide for yourself. You'll get the facts there. Thank you.
Rick, you have anything for town manager?
Well, that doesn't really happen either.
I
have seen a steady decline over the last 12 years on how many people come. So it would be great if more people came. I think last year it was under 75.
Be positive.
Yeah.
Well,
he's positively stating the facts.
Yeah. I think that people should be ashamed of themselves for not coming, but they don't come. And it's been unique watching it over the years because there were a lot of people that did come. They've even stopped coming. That used to be a pain. They've even stopped coming. And it's hard to... So I think that's where there's less people. There's been less complainers. Really. And I don't know what the answer is, but it would be very nice if we could get more people to attend.
It would be great because they really need to be there. It's their tax bill that's the result of this meeting. So for no other reason, they should be there to talk, to ask, to listen, to understand, and to debate the issues and perhaps even amend the articles.
And what happens, Mr. Welch, if after it's looked at, the letter from the state, that the voters don't vote for it? Then what happens?
Well, to me, it's a letter. And, you know, usually when you have a dispute with someone, and I support the taxpayers, that's my job, as well as the board. If they vote not to approve it, then we have a discussion. If they vote to approve it, then we do something else. But it's only a letter. And I think that's the way it stands until such time as the voters have their say.
Okay.
Yeah, so maybe that's something that might make it more inviting to come to the meeting. Particularly if there's this, they have their own time to go to the school deliberative session that they're going to have.
True.
And they can find out a lot more information, and I'm sure people are going to want to be more concerned about how they do spend their money. So this is a perfect time for everybody to get on board and come to the February 4th, right?
February 4th, 8:30 in the morning at the Winnicott High School. And yes, it is very important. I believe we have till February 13th to file an appeal of this letter. February 4th is going to tell us what the citizens want to do.
Mm-hmm.
And they won't be the final vote.
When is the appeal?
February 13th. So
30 days.
We have a habit of throwing appeals in even if we don't have to do them, just to preserve the town's rights.
So this is people's chance. And I think last year we got actually out of there earlier than usual, but people can always come and only go for one part of it. They can look on, they can watch the TV and see what time, you know, when things are going to come up that they're concerned about, or they can come for the morning or come for the afternoon, and it's a ball of fun.
It can be.
Yeah.
Thank part you. Of your civic duty.
Yeah.
You know, as a voter and a taxpayer in this town, it's part of, you know, you should want to be part of that, and you should want to be able to, you know, have, it's your time to have your discussion on what you feel or how you feel your town should be run.
And we're going to have, is somebody going to be, the school using it as to have some selling food and stuff like that?
Oh,
there?
They always sell food. There's always good food
it's
there.
It's usually the 8th grade class trip has been doing it the past couple of years. So.
And they could use everybody's encouragement also.
It's one of the last places in the country where you'll see true democracy being exercised. If you want to keep it, come. If you don't want to keep it, don't bother, because it'll eventually... The legislature this year is trying to redo the whole thing, so they'll disappear. It'll be chaos. It'll be like Ohio if they get their bill through.
Hmm.
So, and that won't be fun at all.
Chaos.
The courts will be deciding what your appropriation is. God... Save us the Lord.
I got a question for you.
Sir.
You're done? We had a request from the Budget Committee to use the Selectmen's Meeting Room on Tuesday the 31st at 7 p.m. I don't believe there's anything on the schedule at that night.
I don't believe there is anything on the schedule at that night.
So if I'd say we go ahead and let them and let the cable committee know to film that meeting. I think that meeting should be filmed. It's as we do with any budget meeting, any selectmen's meeting, any planning board, any zoning board. If it's a public meeting, then it should be filmed. And you can.
You gotta film it. Why don't you just put it on TV?
Then it should be on TV also. I agree. I mean, if they're gonna be here filming it, then it could. There's no reason
it's
for
the
it.
Same process.
Be. Correct. So. Is there consensus of the board to have...
May I, Mr. Chairman, why do you raise that issue? Why is they're all our meetings are publicized.
Well, in her notice says there's no need for the cable crew is not needed.
Whose but notice is that?
That is from Mary Louise Woolsey. She's saying the cable crew is not needed, but I feel if they're having a public meeting, the public has a right to know what's going on at their meetings, and if it's a public meeting, then it should be televised.
It's a budget committee meeting prior to the town meeting?
This is January 31st, Tuesday next week.
That has to be televised.
So, consensus of this board to have it televised?
Absolutely.
Okay. Very good. So, thank you. Old business. 2017 warrant.
Mr. Chairman, yes. This is the evening at which the board would be considering the final form of the warrant. At which time, which is now includes all the articles as they have been previously reviewed and recommended by either this board or by the Budget Committee,
mm-hmm.
and also petitioned warrant articles, some money warrant articles, some not. Over this weekend, I have taken a last look at the form of these of the non-petitioned articles, of the regular articles,
mm-hmm.
and had noted some minor punctuation items to about six of the articles which have been made to the version I'm passing out at
okay.
this time.
And while he's passing those out, why don't you look over these warrant articles over this week, and next week at our meeting, we will discuss who's going to present each one at the deliberative session. So if you've got an article that you want to bring up, look at them this week, and we'll talk about that at next week's meeting.
Mark, did any of these, are any of these substantial changes or just, you know, dramatic?
Commas and, you know, making a plural into a singular.
Okay.
Singular and... No, none of them are what I would call substantive changes.
Okay.
And certainly no dollar amounts are changed.
Okay. The only ones that we might want to look at are Article... let's see, 15, 16, 17, 18, and 19. Or 18, anyways. 18. Because while you were gone, Rick, it wasn't a really substantial change, but there was some wording changed in that, and
I believe the dollar figures
dollar values calculated.
The dollar values recalculated and went down. So we voted them, and so we had them at a 5-0 before. We just wanted to, if you wanted to take a reaffirm of that vote, so that you would be counted in that. So. How would we just...
Well, I guess Selectman Griffin could indicate that his vote is the same, then we would not need to revisit it.
Okay, and which one is this?
These are the collective bargaining articles.
Ones.
They actually went down in value.
They actually went down in value. Yeah. So.
And I'm all on board.
Okay. Thank you.
Good.
You know, to me, that's the most important thing we're facing here.
Absolutely.
This year.
You got that right.
And I think that's the only thing I'm concerned about with all of the... particularly with this sewer thing at the last minute. I just hope that it doesn't cause issues that are going to make other things more difficult.
We also, Article 24, do we need to go through all of them?
No, Mr. Chairman, you could vote the whole warrant in its form because the warrant is under the hands of the selectmen. I think there may have been some votes taken.
Right, there was 24, which was Bicentennial Park, which, Rick, you weren't here for. That's $120,000 for the development, design, and permitting, and it was a 4-0-0 vote. And if you would like to make it, we can reaffirm that vote.
I would like to make that also.
So make a motion to reaffirm that vote now.
I'll make a motion to reaffirm it.
Second. All those in favor? Unanimous. So that's
5-0-0.
5-0-0 on Article 24. For Articles 39, 41, 42, 43, 44, Rick, you were absent for those.
I'm going to abstain from all of them.
Okay.
I think that we should concentrate on the articles that we are in charge of.
Okay.
And that's my feeling. That's the way it was always done in the past. It's been the last few years it's changed, and I don't really see the benefit of it.
The only one is Article 44 is a money article, and we can go with the abstention if you want. That is Article 44 is a petition experience Hampton. At least 25 other Hampton registered voters shall the town raise and appropriate the sum of $300,000 for preliminary design and services of the reconstruction of the Lafayette Road from the area of the intersection of High Street towards Winneconnet Road. The design services should be include street, sidewalk, utilities, lighting improvements in the for the downtown Hampton Village in an effort to revitalize the downtown. The primary preliminary design would be used to support the future projects that have potential to be funded by the Road Improvement Capital Reserve Fund created under Article 16 in the 1998
annual town meeting in accordance with provisions of the RSA 35 for the purpose of maintenance and reconstruction of streets. Said appropriation should to be offset by a donation by Experience Hampton estimated to be $30,000.
So this is just for the plan?
This is for the plan and the
underground utilities.
Yeah, and what are they estimating that it's going to be at?
They don't know.
It's $300,000 for the design work and the engineering and stuff like that. $30,000 of that to be offset by Experience Hampton.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's not that I'm against it, because I'm not. But again, I feel that this is not. You know, these are not something that we've put together. I would really rather concentrate on what we've worked on myself.
Okay.
And I'm not against this, and I'm not against several of these, but I would prefer to, I know, you know, I've listened, and I'm all in favor of it. I would love to have those done everywhere, but I don't think that that's something that we've actually worked on here, and that's why I don't really feel like I have the ability, so I don't want to vote against it.
So it's 3-1-0 right now, and we'll leave it at that?
Okay. Yes. Maybe we could change it at the deliberative session after I hear more.
3-1-1. Right. Yeah. Okay.
Yes. Who voted against it?
Me.
Yeah. Yeah, I would have to really hear more. I don't feel I know enough.
Okay, that's good. That's fine.
And I've listened to everyone. And this is, I know how much it's going to cost. That's why it makes me very nervous. A number of years ago, to do it in a small area, it was over $12 million.
So we'll change that to 3-1-1, and other than that, we need to vote the warrant in.
With those changes.
Make a motion to approve the 2017 warrant.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
And so, the manager, I think, Fred, you were going to be having the board come in at once these are made for a signing.
We need to revise the warrant so that everything is correct in it, we'd ask you sometime after 10 o'clock tomorrow morning if you could drop by the town office and sign the warrant, and we'll
after
then
what time?
After 10.
Yeah.
Give Christine a little time to get done.
The punctuations and that one other
everything
change.
Little things that need to be done, plus including all the proper votes, so that we have all those correct.
Okay, and then also the old business, yes.
Yeah, I'd like to make a motion that recently we've had some communication between the Budget Committee and the New Hampshire Municipal Association, I think, which has gone to the Selectmen also. And I'd like to make a motion to make that communication public and to place it on our website.
Second.
So that the public can see it in transparency. I think we should be transparent in everything and put it out there. Mm.
Motion second?
Yeah, Regina seconded.
All those in favor?
Whoa. I just want to kind of, perhaps you can accept an amendment to it, specifically based on the last meeting we had with the chair of the Budget Committee. There was a email from the chair based on your instruction, Mr. Bridle, from the chair to legal inquiries. It was addressed to Attorney Buckley. That was dated, if you'll amend your motion, to include the email from Mary Louise Woolsey at mlw03842@yahoo.com to legal inquiries at nhmunicipal.org, Saturday, January 14, 2017. It's 7:57 a.m. The subject is RSA 91, and if you would subsequently amend to include the response from legal inquiries, which is from Mr. Buckley, to mlw03842@yahoo.com. Attorney Gerald was copied. That was Tuesday, January 17, 2017, at 1444 hours. Subject RSA 91. He deals not only with the 91A response, but Selectman Woolsey's interrogatory quote, "I hope the Budget Committee will not have to consider hiring counsel as a result of the board accepting Article 44 on the warrant." Would you accept that?
I meant for all of them to be included, so I accept that amendment, absolutely.
Thank you.
Can I just ask one question?
Yep.
And it's kind of not exactly with this, but where I wasn't here last week, and I did watch the meeting and everything. When the original letter was or vote came up about making the request to send a letter to the budget committee about the 91 whatever, and there was a 3-1 vote. There was one vote that had been done at the beginning that got the whole ball rolling, and Jim, I believe, tried to rescind it.
Right.
How was that vote? Who was the one that voted against it at that point?
Jim voted.
And this is the original one.
The original
that you asked to be rescinded.
I was the only one that voted for it, I thought. Or Rusty and I thought that was 2-2.
No, it was 3-something. That's why I came to see Fred today and I forgot to ask
him. They would have rescinded it if it was 3-something.
Right.
It was 1-3, I think.
1-3.
I voted for it.
He voted to rescind it, and it was 3 against.
No, I'm talking about the original one that you tried to change.
Oh, that was a motion by.
It was 3-1. It appeared that there was not only 4 people must have voted on the original thing that's got the whole ball rolling with Mary Louise,
to request the 91A?
Yes.
I think that was unanimous.
I thought that was unanimous.
I thought it said 3-1.
I thought it was unanimous. I think that was unanimous.
Might have been. I have to go back for the notes. I don't.
Yeah. Well, if I would have been here, I would have sided with you that night. So.
Okay. So. We have a motion on the floor. All those in favor? Unanimous. Anything else in the old business? New business. We have an animal license restraining and penalties ordinance. Fred, you want
to? Yeah, I'd be happy to, Mr. Chairman. This is a result of a request that we received from the town clerk's office. We've been doing an awful lot of licensing work on dogs, and I know you folks, every year you get the dog warrant. We're trying to eliminate that down further and further and further. There is a provision in the statutes under licensing where if the town selectman voted, there's an additional $1 sum to help recover the costs of licensing dogs, which has gotten to be rather expensive because we have to chase so many folks. There's also a provision within that statute dealing with the restraint or failure to restrain dogs when they're so ordered by the chief of police or the animal control officer or the board of selectmen. And failure to do that would invoke a $50 fine under the statute. So in preparing this, we have prepared an ordinance, which the statute requires, one by the selectmen, that would, in fact, accomplish all of those particular items.
I'll make a motion that we accept the ordinance.
Second.
Any questions? All those in favor? Unanimous.
Send this around to be signed then. Thank you.
Anything else under new business?
That should be enough.
Seeing none, closing comments.
I would just like to say I made my plan maybe 14 months ago for my vacation to come at that time. I didn't realize that I would. There was only one meeting that I was going to miss when I left, and it's just now. I've had it happen before. I know the time that I missed the election day.
I remember you were planning that, and you're only going to be away for one meeting.
Yeah, so I feel bad about it, but I don't think I would have changed anything if I had been here. But I did keep up on it all the time, and
we missed you.
Yeah, I missed everybody, and I was there in spirit. Thank you.
Yes, we could feel you.
Yes.
Closing comments. For anybody that's interested, the State House is getting really busy. Mr. Bean knows that. Representative Bean knows that, I'm sure. But tomorrow in the Executive Departments and Administration Committee, they're hearing 6 bills that have to do with New Hampshire retirement. And they're interesting, and one of them, I believe, is sponsored by one of our representatives, Rennie Cushing, which is to have the state go back to paying 15% of the employer retirement contribution costs for teachers, police, and firefighters. So if anybody's interested, you know, go on the New Hampshire Municipal Association's legislative bulletin and read them, and keep it best of what's going on in the State House, because it does affect your tax dollars.
And then some.
Anything else?
Yeah, just real quick on that, if I may, pardon me, Rick. At 1330, at Resources, Rec, and Development, it's HB 302. The delegation's got something to study leasing the Hampton Beach State Park from the state. At 1000 HB 328, that Attorney Giraud has worked so diligently on, and I must praise him. He held court for an hour last week in science and technology and briefed the entire committee on that. He's back before a work session tomorrow at 10 a.m. when he gets on board up there. Additionally, Ways and Means is House Bill 357 relative to the appraisal of telecommunications. Over a 10-year period, that was formerly HB 1198. Over a 10-year period, that will cost this town alone close to $200,000 of money that taxpayers will have to make up. So as Jim says, and as Jim commands, we're working in liaisons, both with Rainey. Mike Edgar was by the office today. Mark's working. We're integrating with the special legislative efforts, advancing Hampton's interest and working closely with everybody, Jim. So thank you for that encouragement. Thank you, Mr. Breiter.
Anything else?
I was going to say, it's amazing because so many people either emailed me or let me know about things that they were interested about, but it's amazing how many people follow the streaming that goes on online, because it's an hour and 42 minutes into it. It's an hour and 15 minutes into it. I mean, they could just off the
down
top
to
of their head.
Down to the mini seconds. Yeah.
Makes it much easier.
Absolutely.
People are involved.
They do watch the TV, so that's why it's important that when we have public meetings, that they are televised and they are on, so people can see that. You're absolutely right.
And you can see them even if you're out of the country, so it's really amazing.
Yes, you can. So, motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second? All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.